Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. I'm Dave Plummer, a retired operating systems engineer from Microsoft, going back to the MS-DOS and Windows 95 days. I worked on pretty much every operating system at Microsoft, from MS-DOS through Server 2003, and today I'm going to explain not only why it is that your computer slows down as it ages, but also the top 5 things that you can do to fix it right now. I figure there are 2 scenarios that bring you to this point. Either you're contending with some ancient piece of iron yourself, or to deploy it into some secondary capacity in your home lab. The other, perhaps more likely possibility, is that you've taken mercy upon one of your relatives who is using an older computer where the performance can best be measured on a geological timescale. But is there actually anything you can do about it? The answer is yes. There are actually several things that can and should be done, and we'll cover them all today. You might think it's unavoidable, but it's actually a cumulative process that happens over time, and it's at least partially to mostly reversible. That means you can usually correct a lot of the slowdown problems with the top 5 tips I'll share with you today. Now, you might think that I would have only the latest and greatest hardware for myself, and that vendors and manufacturers constantly shower me with the best of the best. And if my main desktop is in fact the Mac Ultra Studio connected to a Threadripper with 128 gigs of RAM, you might find it hard to muster any sympathy for me whatsoever. And that's fine. But don't worry about me. Think of the children. Specifically, think of my children. That's because our house is equipped with what is known as the craft room. It's almost like a tiny classroom in that each kid has a little locker and then a desk area reserved at the big counter. The whole area is overlooked by mom's desk, and perhaps one of the best decisions we ever made was to make this room the central point of most all family activity in the house. We did this largely by putting each kid's computer down here instead of in their rooms. This also allowed us the ability to at least keep an eye on what the kids are spending most of their time on, though of course they all have iPads and iPhones as well, so it's not exclusive. When I initially built this space out with computers for the kids, I knew that I didn't want a bunch of PC boxes sitting up on top. I really wanted the elegance, uniformity, and simplicity of the iMac hardware, but I was a loyal Microsoft employee, and so, as a result, I wound up buying iMacs, wiping them, and using Boot Camp to install the latest and greatest versions of Windows onto the Apple hardware. And to me, it was the best of both worlds. But there's one fatal flaw with the iMac, and that being that as the computer ages, you've still got a big investment in the display, which is still perfectly fine after all. Nobody wants to throw away a perfectly fine 27-inch 4K or 5K monitor, but other than RAM, you're very much locked into the iPad's CPU and other hardware. As a result, I think a lot of people, myself included, persist in using iMacs with base hardware specs that we'd otherwise haul off to PC Recycle if not for the expensive display. And so I've become a bit of an expert at extending the life of older machines. Before we can fix any of it though, we first need to understand why it is that the computer slows down with age. Now clearly, the hardware is not really getting any slower, as components do not slow down with age, and unlike the unbridled raw speed you experience while the new computer smell is still fresh, the slowdown that's been happening since is probably not just in your head. Just to get it out of the way, because it's something that can happen however, which would be clogged vents, fans, or heat sinks that wind up causing premature thermal throttling. That's about the only real way that I can imagine hardware performance varying with age, absent overclocking. Software, though, is a completely different story. But why? The major reason is that software installations, and in particular the alternating or rotating installation and removal of gains of software, tends to grow and bloat the system, and that strains the resources of the machine in a way that it did not when it was new. And the real problem is that sometimes, if you double the load on the PC, it might become 4 times slower. It's not always linear. For example, if you need 16 gig on a machine that only has 8 gig, it must instead use extremely slow disk-based virtual memory instead, and that is orders of magnitude slower than direct memory access. And conversely, that is why sometimes a small change can have a big impact on performance. Number 1. Removing unused applications and games. Now it seems simple, because it is. Just go into the control panel and remove any applications that you're not using. You should also be judicious about what you install on your machine if it's not something that you really want to become part of your permanent toolset. Consider evaluating games and utilities in a VM if possible. Not all game systems are created equal. Perhaps it's entirely fine to check out, remove, and reinstall dozens of games with a system like Steam, but it's less so if those games are all partying all over the system registry. Speaking of which, the registry is one reason why it's important to use the uninstaller for an application. If written correctly, and that's anything but a given, the uninstaller will remove not only the files and the folders that it created during the original installation, but also things like fonts and entries in the system registry database. Uninstalling a large and complex application can clean out a large swath of registry debris. Now, there are programs that claim to be able to do registry repair and cleaning after the fact, but doing it well and safely is not trivial. Better to use the application's proper uninstaller in the first place. One thing you may not have considered is that if you have a computer that's 8 years old, you're likely not still running 8-year-old software on it. Odds are you've upgraded your software along the way and that those newer versions have grown in size and resource demands. So in that sense, your computer hasn't really gotten any slower, you're just asking something very different of it, and the performance that results is terrible. There are other perceptual changes that might come about, such as perhaps you get the new iPhone and it responds really promptly. If you then go to use a desktop application and it responds more slowly than your phone does, it will feel even slower by comparison, even if nothing has actually changed on the computer. But let's say that you've ruled out simple perceptual changes and that your computer really is getting slower. What can you do about it? Number 2. Software updates. Well, the first thing might seem so minor that you overlook it, but it's actually very important that you always keep your computer up to date with the latest operating system and application patches and updates. Certainly, operating systems can and do grow significantly from one major version to the next, but my experience has been that they actually get faster within minor versions along the way. For example, Win 95 OSR 2 was faster than the original Win 95. At the same tasks, XP was faster than NT4, which was faster than 3.5.1, which was faster than 3.5, which had already been a big improvement over 3.1. How can that be? Well, I can't prove it, but from what I saw inside the industry was that we'd add features on the major version increments and then fix bugs and improve performance for the next minor version increments. And it just makes sense. New operating systems are sold based on new features. As a result, sometimes first you get the features and then they make them fast, because they can't always do both from the outset. This is also true of drivers, particularly graphics drivers. They are constantly evolving and being tweaked. And since many drivers are unified across a wide range of hardware, perhaps your 1070 GTX will pick up a feature or some perf in the new release of the NVIDIA drivers even years later. The same can be true for a new release of something like DirectX. And because the release dates of operating systems, drivers, and SDKs and updates are often staggered, the best thing you can do is just to keep everything up to date with the latest stable versions of everything. Number 3. Startup applications and services. After that, however, we can start to get more proactive and actually undo some of the performance degradation. One of the first things we need to check to see is what programs are starting automatically with Windows. Everything that runs during startup will by definition slow your startup down, and those things that continue running after startup will become a permanent part of the base load of the machine. One of the most important statistics about Windows is the total working set. That is the sum total of all the memory and address range that the operating systems and applications have asked for at any one time. Of course, that total may exceed the amount of physical memory you have, and as noted earlier, once pushed to start using virtual memory to make up for the shortfall, performance craters. Adding RAM to your system, if possible, would be one solution. For an even easier solution, just say hello to my little friend, Task Manager. I wrote the original Task Manager because I was curious about these kinds of statistics on my own machine and how to tweak and optimize them. And one of the key features of Task Manager now is its ability to manage the list of programs that are started automatically with Windows when the desktop starts. Switch to the Startup tab of Task Manager to access and modify the list. One nice feature here is that you can disable an entry without removing it entirely. That allows you to test that everything still works properly when you've turned off a startup application. But what can you safely turn off? Well, generally, I suggest turning off only those things that you're certain you know what they do and that you do not need them. Perhaps there are larger programs like Skype and they're starting in the background each time. If you never need to receive calls or don't use Skype at all, go ahead and turn that off. I'm sure it'll make a big difference. If you're unsure, I suggest that you don't turn things off. If you must, turn off one thing at a time, reboot, and test for any problems. Don't just delete entries entirely, just disable the checkbox. By the way, if you're on some seriously older software like Windows 7, this feature wasn't in Task Manager yet, so you'll need to use a program supplied with Windows called msconfig, and it does much the same thing.
Bonus item, storage device problems.
A number of things I'll talk about in this section apply only to magnetic media and not SSDs, but some things like bloated and abandoned temporary files seemingly never change. So let's go through the list. Mechanical drives suffer from file fragmentation over time, which means that one file is forced to be scattered around the hard drive, so the heads have to jump and move around to read even a single linear file, because there wasn't enough room in any one place to store it in a row. In the old days, you'd fix this with a defrag pass, though it's much less important now with NTFS than it was with the FAT file system. I've heard some folks, including well-known YouTube creators, make the claim that as computers age, they're forced to grow the hard drive storage into areas where the actual media on the platter has a lower angular velocity in terms of rotational speed. They argue that the speed of the media under the drive head is going to be much faster at the outer edges than at the inner tracks, and that this results in slower disk transfers. It's an interesting theory, but it ignores the fact that almost all magnetic computer media uses what's known as constant angular velocity. Regardless of where the heads are, the platter as a whole is always rotating at the same speed. The heads still read and write bits at the same timing as before, and so the bits don't actually come in any faster. Instead, they're just spread further apart. That's why the hard disk geometry is quoted in bytes per sector, sectors per track, and heads per track. The sectors per track number stays constant in most conventional media. Modern drives effectively use a monolithic block count and index and abstract the real geometry away from you, but I could not locate any drives with variable geometry offhand. If you know of any, please let me know in the comments. It's also pretty common for disk formats to store the directory and file information in the middle of the disk. If the outer edge of the media were significantly faster, it's a safe bet that that's where the file system authors would have stored their most important info, but it's just not the case. Now, it's worth noting that sectors per track was actually variable in some floppy disk formats, like the Apple II and the Commodore, where they pack additional sectors into the outer tracks. But it doesn't apply to the media that you're using today. Except for optical stuff, another story.
Number 4. System cleaning and hygiene.
Next, we have the simple task of temporary files and junk that can clutter up your machine, and that brings us to an essential program for your system maintenance named WinderStat. It's an open source GPL app that scans your system to build a map of how every byte on your disk is used. Files are grouped by location and colored by type so that with little practice, you should be able to spot a single large file and large groups of small files. Either should be investigated to determine if it's something that you can remove. Now, don't delete anything you're not sure about, of course, and don't delete anything until you're certain that you've got a working system backup. Now, some things like simply emptying the recycle bin are pretty low risk, but don't just start nuking large files that you're not familiar with. For example, in the root folder of the boot drive, there very might well be a file called hyperfile.sys, and it could take up gigabytes of space, but don't delete it. Now, like me, you might say, but I've never used Hibernate in my life, and I don't plan to start. If that's the case, you should use the powerconfig/hibernate option to disable a feature, which will in turn remove the file. Let's take a quick look. Mine's about 27 gigabytes in size, and that's huge. But if I run powerconfig and turn it off, it's gone and I get 27 gigabytes of space back. That could be worth the price of admission to this video alone, so you're welcome. The other big one is pagefile.sys, but that one's pretty much required. However, if you have more than one drive, you can move it to a different drive, and it's something I would recommend doing if you have a drive that's faster than your boot volume, or if you're pressed for space on that boot volume. The only problem is that they've seriously buried this setting. It's not available in the new settings UI, and it keeps getting pushed further and further back into the murky depths of the old UI. So to get there, we start out at System. Next, we select Advanced System Settings. Oh, but we're not even close. We next go to the Advanced tab and click on the button in the Performance Settings section. From there, we click on the Advanced tab yet again, then Virtual Memory, and then, finally, we select Change. Now, as I said, you need to have a paging file, but where it lives is up to you. If you wish to move yours to another drive, I suggest you create a System Managed page file on the desired drive and then remove the original System Managed one on the boot drive. It won't take full effect until you restart the system.
Another free bonus item, proper malware removal.
Your next step, and don't assume it's not important, is scanning for viruses and malware. It's not so much that the viruses themselves actually consume very much in terms of resources, but malicious code might very well install software that harvests your PC resources to become a spam bot or crypto mining zombie, either of which will definitely slow things down. Your most precious PC resources like RAM and CPU will be used for nefarious purposes and therefore not available for your own use. There are tons of antivirus programs out there, but I'm going to put a stick in the ground here and say that all you really need is Microsoft Defender. They've got their top people on it, and I know that for a fact, because the guy that runs dev for it used to work for me, and he's really good. I trust him with my security, and you likely should as well. After all, the Defender team isn't selling anything, and they're trying to bolster the security image of Windows. It's a win-win when your interests are that closely aligned and no money changes hands. Number 5. System File Repair. It's worth your time to check two things on your disk. Run a check disk to scan for errors. You can supply the /F option to ask it to automatically fix anything it finds wrong, but I prefer to do a separate scan pass first so that I know what my options are and what's going on. You can also run the system file scanner, sfc/scan now, which will test, validate, and repair any system files that may have been replaced by unofficial and potentially buggy or slow third-party replacements. With your system fully updated, cleaned of junk files and malware, fully tuned and optimized for disk space, your system is about as fast as it can be. Your much more drastic alternative is to clean format the machine and reinstall Windows, but that's a significant investment of time on your part. In some rare cases of a machine where the software installations or configurations have been damaged extensively, it might still be your best option and last resort. If, along the way, you found today's episode to be any combination of entertaining or informative, I'd be honored if you considered leaving a like and subscribing to my channel. If you have any interest in matters related to autism, Asperger's, or ASD, please check out my book on Amazon, Secrets of the Autistic Millionaire. It has nothing to do with money and everything to do with living a successful life on the spectrum. It's everything I know now that I wish I'd known back then. Remember, I'm mostly in this for the subs and likes, so please be sure to leave me one of each before you go today. In the meantime and in between time, I hope to see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.
Do it, Lynn! Do it!